It is the year 539 BC. Israel, the kingdom of David, is no more. Divided and conquered, they are scattered among the nations. The tribes of Judah and Benjamin are captive in Babylon. Among the captives from Judah is Daniel. Passionately loyal to the God of his ancestors, Daniel has won the favor of his captors and occupies a position of influence in Babylon. Though his prominence in Babylon affords him much freedom and many benefits, peaceful sleep evades faithful Daniel. His body tosses and turns upon his bed, his soul churning in turmoil with dreams and visions of world-changing events yet to come.
Another vision, Daniel. It is obvious, Daniel. The Lord has selected you to be his prophet.
And I'm thankful for his affection, Meshach. But I don't know if this body can bear these revelations.
What did you see in your vision?
As in the first, the fall and rise of empires,
and what, Daniel?
Israel will be in the midst of these empires. There is a time of great suffering coming upon our people. A tyrant will arise, arrogant and proud. He will exalt himself against our God and his commandments.
More affliction?
It is far in the future, Meshach. We will not live to see it.
We're in the middle of it now. Will our people ever know peace?
We mustn't lose heart, Meshach. Our God is faithful. He didn't allow you to perish in the fiery furnace, nor me in the lion's den.
You're right, of course. Our people have never been forsaken. But if this is for the distant future, then so is the coming of the Messiah. Will the kingdom ever be restored?
We will, as sure as the sun rises. All God's words are true. Soon the present kingdom will pass. When the 70 years prophesied by Jeremiah are complete, we will return to the land. We and all this generation will go the way of all the earth. Then God will accomplish the words. He will accomplish the words of this vision.
Then we must intercede for our people.
Yes. Then I must write the vision in a book.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam.
The visions of Daniel come to pass, The Babylonians, the Medes, and the Persians disappear into history, and Alexander the Great rises in their place. Caught in the middle, tiny Israel comes under Greek rule. But a greater menace threatens their national existence. Greek art, philosophy, science, and pleasure seduces many Jews away from their faith and culture. A few, keenly aware of the darkness that threatens to engulf them, resist. In Modin, a small village northwest of Jerusalem, a priest of the people of Israel named Mattathias is committed to uphold the name of God, his commandments, and his people, Israel.
All Torah scrolls are to be given up and burned. If it is known that we possess even a portion, we shall be killed. Did you know about this?
Hannah, can we live without the commandments of our God? Isn't it written that his words are our light, our life, our nourishment, his wisdom, that when the other nations will hear it, they will say, this great nation is a wise and understanding people. What great nation has such statutes and righteous judgments? What are we without Torah? What are we without the covenants?
Father, we also delight in his word. You have taught us well.
For many centuries, pagan empires have ruled over us. We have outlived them all. This tyrant, this madman, he wants more than dominion over us. He wants to destroy the memory of our people and our God from the face of the earth.
Yes, Father, I understand. I'm not asking that we should deny the name of our God or our names. Let us use wisdom. Let us be patient and pray. What happened in Jerusalem does not need to be repeated here in Modin.
I'm afraid that what happened in Jerusalem might soon happen here.
After all, his words are not written only on scrolls, but also in our hearts. Let them be burned in the streets and consumed. Let us preserve life, that the fire in our hearts may not be quenched. One day we will again write down his laws. You have 5 sons and 3 daughters. Will you lose it all with your zeal?
Who are we but the seed of Abraham, the friend of God? Who can we be but the sons of Israel? No, this Torah shall not depart from my mouth.
Antiochus Epiphanes launches a campaign of terror against the Jews in an attempt to forcibly convert them to the Greek way of life. He outlaws their faith and customs. Those who do not comply suffer punishment, brutal, fatal. Men, women, children, no one is spared the wrath of Antiochus.
Sire, we found the woman.
Why am I here?
Your husband.
My husband is dead, murdered at your command, along with hundreds of my people in Jerusalem.
They all died for nothing.
They died loyal to our God. Why am I here?
The people listened to your husband, now they listen to you.
Yes, I encourage our people to resist your madness.
Do you have children? Do you have children?
Yes.
Tomorrow in the afternoon on the east wall.
As you wish, my lord.
been here 4 hours. I'm tired. They're tired. Eat this meat. Let's go home. Meat, you worthless dog. Meat is meat. What is the difference of one meat to another? Cow, goat, swine, it's all flesh.
There is no difference. Only that my God has declared swine unclean. It is not food for our people.
And what? Will it sicken you if you eat it? Will you die?
I will not be clean, unable to enter our temple to worship.
Have some pork.
I have kept the commandments since childhood, and I will not dishonor my God.
You've served him all these years.
Obedience to his law has brought me blessing and a good life. I will live longer. I will not even to prolong my life.
You would die for your God?
Yes.
Shema Israel. Adonai. Eloheinu.
The concerns of Mattathias the priest were not unfounded. An officer is commissioned by Antiochus and sent to Modin. With a plan to gain Mattathias' cooperation, Antiochus hopes to accomplish his aims.
Mattathias Hasmoneus of the Hasmonean dynasty. I do apologize for my man. These days our soldiers aren't known for their manners, I'm afraid. You are Mattathias, are you not?
I am.
Wealthy, prominent, influential, husband of one wife, father to 5 sons and 3 daughters, loyal to your God, your invisible God, your one God.
I am.
And you are?
I'm Judah, his son.
Ah, yes. Judah Maccabee, the hammer. Interesting name. I see you recognize Justice. His name is now Jason. As you can see, he's embraced our way, as have many of your people. Would you like to know the true extent of his devotion to Greece? Jason is no longer circumcised. Our surgeons are extremely skilled. Jason loves the gymnasium. He loves the games. His circumcision was an embarrassment. No longer.
Daniel rejected the food of Babylon, risking death. Eleazar accepted death to remain clean before the Lord. You mutilated your flesh and removed the seal of God's covenant, so that you could play.
The world is changing, Judah. The entire world is Greek. I'm just keeping in step with it.
The earth is the Lord's justice, and we are his people. The Lord is the same. He never changes.
Enough!
I have read your sacred writings, Mattathias, and I must say, they are imaginative. You really believe you were chosen by God, the one true God? His special treasure, a kingdom of priests, a holy nation? Oh my. But I know your history too. You are a forsaken people. Your people have done nothing for centuries. Like a concubine, you are cast from one king's bedchamber to another. Today, you belong to Antiochus Epiphanes, God in the flesh. Tomorrow, you will meet Jason and I at the place of worship. You will offer a sacrifice to the gods of Greece in front of the people. They will see that you have accepted our way of life, and they will follow in your example. Everyone will be happy and alive. Accept reality, Judah. The glory of Greece will cover the earth. Do not stand in its way.
You're wrong. We have the promises of our God. His word is light and life. Greece will go the way of all the other empires, and they will be forgotten. Our Messiah will come. With the brightness of his coming, he will destroy all the enemies of righteousness. He will establish the kingdom of our father David in Jerusalem. From Jerusalem, he will send forth Torah to the nations. They may learn the word of God and do the word of God. Then his glory will cover the whole earth.
Tomorrow, Mattathias.
Everyone who loves Torah and the covenants, follow me.
Hannah, find Judah. Tell him.
On the 25th day of the month of Kislev, Antiochus Epiphanes descended upon us with murderous rage, ransacked our temple and desecrated it. Thousands of our people perished. The outlaw declared us criminals. We continue to worship our God. We do not serve the gods of Greece. Yesterday, my father killed one of Antiochus' top officials who would have forced him to sacrifice at a pagan altar. By now, news has reached Antiochus' headquarters. Shortly, he will send his armies here to punish us with severity, punish our defiance. My father, my brothers, the
small group of our brethren are hiding in the hills outside of Modin. I will join them. We will fight for freedom. We are not the sons of Greece. We are the sons of Abraham. We will no longer bear with the test to put out the light of our God. We will not worship the gods of Greece. Whatever the cost, we will fight till we have cast this yoke off of our shoulder. You are the heads of your families. Return to your villages. Gather to yourself everyone who will fight willingly for the deliverance of our people.
Understand, this war will not be about size or skill in warfare. It will be about faith. Faith in our God, in His Word, in His purposes for our lives as a people. We will not look at the size of our enemy and fear. We will believe. We will believe that our God goes before us. We will remember Gideon and his 300. We will remember Joshua at the walls of Jericho. David and his 5 smooth stones. We will remember that the battle is the Lord's. In His name, we shall do valiantly. He shall gain the victory. Tonight, we pray. Tomorrow, we fight. In the name of the Lord our God, for Torah and for the covenant.
News of the revolt of the Maccabees goes from village to village. A small band of faithful Jews respond to the call to the war for freedom. Under the leadership of Judah and his brothers, they launch a fierce campaign of guerrilla warfare. Though few in number and armed with crude weapons, they inflict upon the armies of Antiochus defeat after crushing defeat. For 3 years, the tiny army called the Maccabees hammer away at the superior Syrian Greco forces with shouts of praise. In prayer and fasting, they fight. Although they suffer heavy losses, they persist, unrelenting in their quest for freedom. Finally, in 165 BC, 10,000 Maccabees faced 60,000 enemy soldiers in 2 battles between Hebron and Jerusalem. Miraculously, the enemy is defeated and driven out.
I have news from Jerusalem! Glorious news!
have news. A messenger came to Medea hours ago. The armies of Antiochus have been defeated. They are retreating. The Maccabees reclaimed Jerusalem.
This war.
The temple has been cleansed and rededicated. They found one cruse of oil that was undefiled. The menorah in the holy place. The fire has been kindled.
The temple in Jerusalem was cleansed and rededicated on the 25th of Kislev, exactly 3 years to the day it had been defiled. A sacrifice was offered on a new stone altar, while Levites played instruments and sang. The Maccabees decided to celebrate the rededication for 8 days. It was the birth of a new feast, Hanukkah, the feast of dedication.